Nigel.
Just a quick question, really, on clarification. You said earlier, or earlier today, that this applies to EU nationals. Is that by residence, by birth, by passport holder?
The regulation says data subjects in the EU.
Does EU nationals anywhere in the world?
In. Right? Residents, visitors, guests, itinerant workers, immigrants, people flying through the airspace.
And resident in the EU?
In, no, not residents, data subjects in the EU. So it's their physical location is what makes them subjects. But of course, that just relates to subjects in the EU. You also then, from a territorial perspective, you've got to consider where you are as a processor. So if you are a data controller or a processor and you're in the EU, you're caught by the regulation, even if you're processing non-EU data subject data. So if all you did was process Chinese people's data, the fact that you are, your business is in the EU, actually by the regulation as well. And then you've got more complicated scenarios where you might be outside the EU as an organisation, and then you've got the degree of interpretation about whether you're actively targeting EU residents, within the EU via things like website activity. So there's a judgment that you have to make there about whether you would be deemed to be trying to target those people within the EU. So in the case of, say, if Facebook had all its operations in the United States, and I know it doesn't because it has them all over the world, but let's just imagine it did. The fact that it's offering services that are clearly available and targeted to data subjects within the EU would mean it is caught by regulation, even though that data might physically never be. It's complicated to speak to a lawyer. If you've got an unusual situation, you do need to stay in the box. That's complicated too. So there are all sorts of articles in this regulation that talk about identifying your supervisory authority that's applicable to you. If you're a single country business with single country customers, it's easy, it's the country you're in. All the other scenarios are complicated. So if you're a multinational, you've got a group structure, you've got to go through a complicated process of working out whether you want supervisory authority in each country in which you operate, whether you want to nominate one as a lead, you go through a one-stop shop approach.
Okay, thanks. We had one question here and then one there next. So, Glenn.
So, data controllers and data processors. What's the position if you choose to use cloud services?
Most processors are positioning themselves right now as processors. Sorry, most cloud service providers are positioning themselves right now as processors for lots of different reasons. One, because they genuinely believe they are. Two, because they're trying to mitigate risk, get risk onto an organisation. However, there's a strong debate as to whether that's an appropriate judgment to make. Given the fact that if you think about the test being whether you dictate me to the purpose of the processing, that's the test as to whether you control your processing. So if you dictate in whole or in part the means and the purpose of the processing, that makes you very likely or absolutely likely to be a data controller. And the argument of cloud providers is because they control downstream supply, it gives them the scalability, which is part of the offering that you can pay your money for, you know, the fact that they can fail over from one data center to another and so on. There's a strong body of argument that says that that actually makes the data controller into those downstream suppliers at the very least, if not the data controller in respect of the data they're putting into the cloud. So they are making clear decisions about the needs and purposes of the process.
So I'm getting from that it's recognised as being an issue, but it's not clear yet.
Yeah, as I say, the cloud providers are taking a very strong stance. Whether that ultimately would require a court case to test, it will absolutely. One of the big cloud providers, I'm sure, will end up in the courts at some point, postman today, then we'll all have it.
Sure. My understanding is that if National Grid choose to use a vendor to process data for me and they use a cloud-based solution, it's National Grid's the data controller's choice. So it's got a contract with the processors as relevant and tell them how the rules by which that needs to be processed. And it's where that cloud service, how you define where that cloud service is hosted from or supported from, whether it includes international transfers. I think that's more the game where it starts to get a bit more murky.
I think it's an issue because if you are a data processor, to an extent you're beholden to your client and you could end up in conflict with them.
Yes,
next, sir, then Mark after.
Sure. I'm just reading the paper. Terrible confession to make, isn't it? But I'm reading this page, which says coalition of chaos. Now, naturally, that doesn't refer to you at all. But the question that occurs to me is, do you see any signs of a non-EU, UK GDPR breaking out before 25th of May 2018?
No.
The
issue for the UK will be equivalence, because it got touched upon in the presentations, but when we cease to be part of the EU, just as the US has safe harbour and privacy shield itself, and safe harbour and privacy shield, the UK will have to apply to the EU for an equivalency decision. That may or may not be given. A challenge for the UK getting an equivalency decision is the nature of the intelligence service surveillance that we do in the UK, which is far above what is deemed normally appropriate in the mainland EU, and is certainly not strictly lawful. When we look at the articles of the EU, the articles and the regulations of GDPR, sorry. So again, there's a lot of people reckon there's serious questions about whether we've been given an adequacy decision. Now, you've got to consider that on the one hand, and then the consequences of no decision on the other hand, which would mean effectively the cessation of all person-based flows between the UK and the EU. It's clearly not in anyone's interest at all, from either side of the argument. But notwithstanding that, they have to uphold the law. If the law says that our intelligence services can't do the sorts of things they do to try and prevent some horrible incidents that occurred recently, you're probably going to get some form of standing in front of you, and then who knows what the compromise might look like.
So there is a... There is a question that has come up sometimes, is that if you've got an international business and you've got lots of customers in the EU, but you've also got customers who are not in the EU and will never be in the EU, and you've got the ability to process their data outside. So does it make sense to have kind of two different sets, two different regimes, one GDPR compliant regime for the EU people, and another different setup for people in other parts of the world? And although that, as a theoretical question, people seem to be kind of interested in debating that, but I have not come across, and none of my clients are remotely interested in having that differentiation. They say, look, if we have to do that for you, we will do it for everyone. It's just going to be too much hassle to kind of try to be clever about this.
So one thing worse than one regulation, it's more than one regulation.
Absolutely. Mark was next.
Back to the controller processor relationship. If a commodity processor tests a data breach on behalf of the work they're doing for their data controllers, would they notify their controllers, or would they also be obliged to notify their own data?
Controller, I mean.
Right?
Controller.
That's probably one of the contractual clauses that goes in between controller and processor.
And if the controller is obliged to notify their own data.
And to be clear, somebody mentioned the 72-hour clock that starts ticking in ticks from when the controller is notified. So the compulsion on the processors to notify without undue delay control as quickly as possible. Once the controller knows, that's when the service to our clock starts to be to notify the data protection authority and jurisdictions.
Sir, you're next.
So going back to the explanation and logic behind decisions that you make in terms of pricing, how would that affect a company's IP? So if you're rating insurance products, how granular does that logic and that decision making process and how transparent does it need to be?
We're having lots of conversations with lawyers about that one, as you imagine. My view is that there are specific references to intellectual property within the regulation, and there's no absolute need for a firm, Philips Insure, any other organisation to dispose of its intellectual property. The situation you run into is when your intellectual property would be revealed as a consequence of some fundamental rights and freedoms of the data subject. So, for example, if you're trying to explain the logic of what you do, and you're talking about logic in layman's terms, if that in and of itself would reveal an intellectual property, for example, a third-party data source that you might use to enrich data to then make determine an underwriting factor, which you can associate with the which drives the price, if just giving a plain English description of that reveals that intellectual property, you're just going to have to do it. And you can imagine that there are all sorts of opinions around that. Because our pricing analytics people obviously don't give away how we calculate premium. Because then you'll have people manipulating how they present and trying to massage the quote, effectively, which is not anyone's interest.
So is there any...
You have to look at each case individually. You know, the test is really, is your description adequate to meet the rights and freedoms of today's subject? Or is it unnecessarily description, in which case can you do all by limiting the description if you like? Or actually, do you have to go the whole hog and describe it in such a way that it's just going to reveal what we do and how we do it? And each case is different, really.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to know until the court's been developed how this is going to be interpreted. There are clearly some aspirations on the part of the of some of the politicians in Europe to be quite tough on algorithms profiling, but how that's actually going to work out, we don't know.
When the main right for data subjects when you look at it, the regulation talks about profiling and automated individual decision making. So profile, we do both as an insurer. Some people just do profiling unless the automated individual decision making part. And fundamentally, everyone's got a right to object to that and have a decision reviewed. But you know, good firms that behave diligently and appropriately towards their customers probably already have those rights to review anyway. You know, if you're not happy about something, you can make a complaint. And if you make a complaint, you investigate it. So fundamentally, that's the mechanism that firms need to provide to their customers, to their data subjects. And as I say, most probably do that already. You might see a high level of challenge, so there'll be a greater level of awareness. But if you make the sound decisions, there's no need for you to review it. So you just have to review it.
Thanks. We've got time for one more quick question. You were first up.
Yeah, I'm just trying to get the scope of this. If I'm an EU citizen and I'm working in America or China, and I have obviously some data around my employment, is that covered under GDPR?
Depends on the control of the processor.
I was told as well, when I was in the US recently as well, where we debated this in National Grid, it's relevant where the data is collected. So, say for example, if an EU citizen, like a National Grid employee, decides to go and work in National Grid US, and they get onboarded in the US, and all the personal data that's collected about them is collected in the US, yeah. It will be under the auspices of the US regulations, not GDPR. So they are, I don't know if they're classed as that.
Whereas if they're working for you and they were...
If it was collected, if they started off life as in National Grid UK, we collected a lot of personal data about them and then transferred it with them over to their job in the US, then that it would be relevant to on the duty
guard. If you then relocate back to the UK, supported by the regulations, you're in the EU, if they employ a new processor, in the EU, it's then caught by the regulation. And if National Grid decides to cease operations in America and move all the data back onshore into the EU, then you'd be caught. But otherwise, if the collection is outside, you as a data subject are outside, processing is outside, then it's not caught by the regulation.
Great, thanks very much. We've come to the end of our time now. Please.